Hey, Coach Terry, how are you doing today?
Pretty good, Alex. Nice to talk to you.
Yeah, nice to see you, Coach. Been a little while.
A month or so, month and a half after all this stuff started happening.
Definitely. Why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Sure. Terry Deremer, men's tennis coach at Fairmont State University.
And what's your background with tennis, Terry?
I go back a long way, Alex, a long time. I got in tennis late. I was like 26 before I started playing tennis and got into tennis after I went to Fairmont State, got drafted in baseball. I was a baseball player at Fairmont and played 4 years in the minor leagues with the Mets, and then got out and started my master's degree at West Virginia University. And that's where I started playing tennis and got involved in tennis. I started teaching, back in 76, 77. And then started and got the West Virginia University tennis job in 79, I think, 79, 80. And then after, I don't know how many years it was, 14, 15 years, and taught in Morgantown, teaching in Morgantown all those years, and then came to the Greenbrier Hotel and as a head tennis pro and ended up the director of tennis at the Greenbrier for 15 years. And somehow I got back to Fairmont State and starting my second year.
Great. So, Terry, obviously you coached at WVU for, 14 or 15 seasons in the 80s and 90s. Right. What do you think for you has been one of the biggest differences coming from a Division I background going to now your alma mater at Fairmont State?
Well, I think obviously the biggest thing is the budget. Yeah. Budgets. Budgets and scholarship levels are completely different. Budgets at West Virginia, when I was there, we were in the football team was great, you know, playing for national championships, and they were bringing in a lot of money, and that trickles down into the other sports. So we were able to, you know, have a pretty good budget, able to travel and bring teams into Morgantown. You know, so Division II is, I mean, you're doing a lot more fundraising. You know, you don't have as much funds to deal with, and facilities pretty good. We, you know, it's, Fairmont has nice outdoor courts, no indoor courts, but I guess budgets are probably the biggest factor.
I'd say another key difference would be you probably weren't driving around any white vans at WVU, were you?
No, I was still driving. Yeah, we didn't really at the start, we were driving. Then we were able to get a pretty big bus to drive in with a driver. So that was that was nice.
It was a little bit easier. What would you say so far in your, I guess, 2 years at Fairmont has been some of the most rewarding things about coming back to college tennis and now being at your alma mater, where you didn't mention that you're also a Hall of Famer.
Well, yeah, it's nice to be back in college tennis. Probably the biggest thing that I miss in college tennis is, the relationships with the players. You know, working with and developing the players. And then the other big thing I miss was the competition, competing, against the other schools. And you miss that. When you're just teaching, and you have competition when you're developing juniors. But it's not the same as coaching a team. Yeah. So, and coming back to Fairmont was, the only reason I really took the job was because of Fairmont. You know, I graduated there a long time ago, I guess, I don't know, 50 years ago. going back on campus, being on campus, has been great. You know, developing the new relationships with the coaches there now is good. And, the Fairmont has a special feeling, always will. So it's nice to be there.
Did you ever think after your 20 plus year hiatus from college tennis that you'd ever be back in the game?
Not really. You know, once I came to the Greenbrier, I mean, that was a pretty, you know, pretty nice job, you know, in tennis. And, I was really staying there until I basically retired from the Greenbrier. And things just developed where I ended up at Fairmont. So, but it's nice to be back, you know, competing again.
Definitely. So I guess we're going to switch gears just a little bit. At what point did you guys start to realize that maybe the season probably wouldn't continue? And did the team already kind of have an idea of that before you were really able to sit down and explain with them? Or kind of how did that process work for you guys?
We were probably, it's probably like a lot of teams. We were on our spring break trip, and we left on March the 8th. And really, when we left, we didn't think anything was going to happen, you know. So, you know, we played, three matches. The fourth match is March the 12th. And before the match started that morning, things started happening in the news about college sports, you know, being shut down. So, we were playing Belmont Abbey, you know, at Belmont, and the coach there, before the match started, should we go ahead and play this match or not? So we said since we're here, and we decided to play. And I think the players knew, we all knew it was going to be the last match, of the year, you know. So it ended up being a great match. We won a close match, so that was a good feeling, and good feeling for the players. So coming home, coming back to Fairmont into what's happening now.
Definitely. And for you guys, it was nice, especially because I know you had three seniors, and it was nice to send those guys out on a high note. I know the situation's been pretty difficult on all of us, just as far as the season ending. I think, what'd you guys play, 5 or 6 matches?
Yeah, we got five in. And, the seniors are, they're looking, of course, looking forward to the season. We were developing, things were looking good. We were playing good. And the seniors looking forward to the season, to the conference matches, conference championships. You know, so, but you know, that's nothing we can do. And two of the seniors are not going to come back. You know, they're going to graduate, and they're not going to use that year. We might have one player come back. He hasn't decided yet. So we might have. He might play another year.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting situation for teams with a lot of seniors because, some coaches have already brought in players to fill those scholarships. So at what point does a school tell you, no, you can't bring someone back? Maybe not in your situation, but, a team with, let's say, 4 seniors and 3 of them want to come back, but you've already got 3 scholarships replaced. You know, the school has the power to just say, no, someone's got to go.
Yeah, I don't know. It comes down to the financial, what the school can afford. I think they're going to try to make it happen for everybody. It might be hard to say, we can't do it, but I mean, it's going to be interesting. It's going to be interesting if those seniors, from other schools, they come back. I think it's going to be, I don't know how many, what the percentage would be. Depends on the situation with the kid.
Yeah, because for men's tennis, it's 4.5 full scholarships is like the limit, and basically the NCAA is saying you can go over that now. So some schools next year could be at 6.5 scholarships, which if you have seniors, that's a huge advantage. At Salem we had no seniors on either side, so we don't even have that luxury of potentially being able to do that. So it could definitely see some super teams next year.
Yeah, it's going to make some teams pretty strong. When a kid's a senior, the student's a senior, to come back another year, I mean, that's adding another year, of school. I don't know. I think it'd probably be, 50%, half and half of players that would come back.
Yeah, because I think by the time most kids are there at their fourth year, a lot of them are, I wouldn't say done, but emotionally, you know, they've got one season left and they're going to leave it all out there and they're ready to move on with their lives.
Right.
Have you been able to keep up in touch with your team? And, you know, if so, how have they been spending their time?
Yeah, we talk really at least once a week and not twice a week with texting. And then we did a Zoom meeting call last week, the first time we figured out how to do it. So we're going to keep doing those. We'll do one this week. And phone calls too, you know, talking on the phone. We have kids in overseas, you know, out of the country, and you know, one in Brazil and Portugal and Germany and Australia. We actually have two players still in Fairmont. They decided, their family decided just to wait it out a little bit in Fairmont. One's from Brazil, one's from Poland. So they're waiting maybe to leave either end of this week or next week. We're staying in touch and try to keep everyone positive.
Definitely, I think during times like these, it's really important for all of us to stay together and stay in touch and to keep each other's mentalities positive, because definitely there's some people that are probably not feeling too positive about these times right now.
Yeah, and for the students, you just want to keep them, you don't want to think that you forgot about them, and you know, they're just out there dangling around, but a lot of the college tennis players, they're all they're good students and good people, and you know, we just want them to be safe and their families be safe.
Definitely. Coach, how have you been spending your time personally during the lockdown?
Oh, it's been going crazy. it's probably the longest time I've been away from tennis, you know, in 45 years or more. Yeah, you know, so missing tennis, missing teaching tennis. And I've really been going, you know, just kind of going crazy. I walk twice a day. Morning walk and evening walk, and try to get about, I don't know, 6 or 7 miles in a walk, and playing some pickleball outside pickleball with some people. I'm in Lewisburg, West Virginia, and trying to stay active, stay in shape.
You've been playing singles or doubles?
Oh, doubles. Singles is too tough.
Oh, come on, Coach.
It's too hard. Yeah, just doubles. You know, we hope to play some tennis once it gets a little warmer. We hit some tennis balls. I'm in Greenbrier County. It's dangerous, but it's not. We don't have a lot of cases, and it's still dangerous. But you know, still trying to be that social distance stuff.
Yeah, fortunately for us, we're in West Virginia, where at least, you know, the state doesn't have as many cases. Like you said, it's still dangerous, and, you know, you want to be careful and socially distanced, but, you know, there's not very many cases here. It could be a lot worse. We could be in New York or California or somewhere.
Right.
What has your role been like at Fairmont State since the quarantine? I mean, are you able to, have you still been recruiting some, or, you know, what other roles have you taken?
Yeah, we've the Fairmont coaches. We started a Zoom meeting last week, and we're going to keep having those weekly meetings with the other coaches at school. And really, paperwork is always still keeping paperwork and training and stuff, just trying to. Trying to get ready for when we go back, trying to do some camps and tournaments and things at Fairmont, just trying to get ready. Recruiting, everyone's all committed, so we're really not doing doing, you know, hardly any recruiting, just trying to stay in touch with the recruits that would be coming in.
Yeah, I know it's one thing for us that, you know, changes up a little bit is the fact that we planned on going down to the state tennis tournament and, you know, seeing if there was any kids left over that were still looking. So it definitely, for some American kids in all states who hadn't committed yet, it's going to make it a little bit more difficult for them to find a home now with no high school season and no high school state tennis tournament.
Yeah, it really, you know, put a hamper to high school tennis, and the kids aren't getting looked at unless they're playing the USTA tournaments, you know, whenever they start.
Yeah, and I know that the USTA already actually canceled their nationals, which are like in October, and I think it's due to the fact that there's they don't think there's going to be any qualifying tournaments this summer, or at least not as many. So I know right. That's going to change a lot of things for kids who are looking to play college tennis.
Yeah, it's tough, and yeah, as you know, we don't even know what's going to happen in the fall. I mean, to be honest, I don't see how they can have unless there's, you know, the vaccine, you know, it's not going to come out that soon, and having kids on campus, I don't know. It's going to be, I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, right now for us recruiting, we've all the recruiters and recruits are questioning us about what's going to happen for the fall, and we're just as clueless as everyone else. We really don't know. I know the rumor has been that maybe all schools will be online for the fall, and if that's the case, that definitely will change the landscape of college tennis a lot for next year in all sports.
Yeah, I don't know what's going to, you know, how would they handle the athletes, you know, if it's online. And then, of course, you got college football that brings in a lot of money to particularly Division I schools. Yeah, so it's crazy. It's really crazy.
What are you most looking forward to about getting back to college tennis, whenever that may be?
Well, it's, you know, it's relationships. You know, working with the players. You know, working with players in helping them get through college and, you know, get ready for, you know, for their careers outside of college. But, you know, the relationships with really the players and the other coaches at school and the people at school. So,
yeah, I think for us, that's what we're most looking forward to. I mean, normally for the summer, we'd only be away from the players for maybe 2.5 months, 3 months. And now we're looking at maybe 5 months if we come back in the fall, and maybe closer to a year if they don't come back for the spring, and that's a long time to be away from your student athletes.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, to be honest, I mean, not even second semester, you know, that you might lose a whole year.
I know.
So, I don't
know. Now you're talking doomsday, Coach.
I know.
And I got just really one more question for you. You know, I know you're a part of the college recruiting board on Facebook, and you've been seeing some of the news of college tennis programs being cut at all divisions. Just last week, University of Missouri Kansas City Division I was cut. St. Edward's Division II nationally top 25, men's and women's was cut. Division II Staten Island was cut this past week. What do you think about the recent, you know, programs being cut, and how do you think this will affect the landscape going forward?
Well, I think it's, of course, you hate to see the teams, you know, cut, you know, the athletic directors have to make a decision, I guess, on what to do with finances. It's not just tennis. I mean, you're looking at the other, you know,
small sports.
Yeah. The everything from golf to cross country, but, you know, it comes down to finances, really, and you know, especially if there's no college football, you know, it's going to be tough to deal, and not only Division II or Division III, it's going to be Division I teams that, you know, they're going to be looking at. So, and like you say, that one, was it St. Andrews?
St. Edward's, Division II school in Texas.
Yeah, I mean, they're a top Division II team, you know, and So it's not so much if you're a good team or a poor team, it's, it comes down to finances.
Yeah. And, I was reading about University of Missouri, Kansas City. I think they'd won 5 conference championships in the past 10 years. So they were arguably the most successful program in their conference, a Division I conference. And even they got cut. So like you said, success on the court really isn't a factor when the athletic directors are looking at finances and, you know, how they can cut back.
Yeah, it's not only athletics too. I'm sure the college presidents, they're looking at the whole landscape of the whole university, you know, not just athletics, but, you know, they're going to make some hard decisions about all the departments.
Definitely. I guess just for us, you know, over the next few months, we're just going to have to sit around and wait a little bit longer and hope for the best, huh?
Yeah, just keep watching the news, I guess. Watching the news and hope it's for the best. You know, you hope it doesn't, you know, rev up again in the fall. You know, so, you know, that could be a deterrent for second semester. So we just have to keep doing what we're doing and hopefully get through this.
Definitely. Any closing thoughts, Coach, or anything else you'd like to talk about before we get off here?
No. I just missing everybody, and also the teaching. I'm back teaching again in Morgantown, and you're up there, Alex. Miss Doug and Micah and everybody up there, and Michaela at Summit, and just really, you know, you kind of, you know, realize how many people you miss when you don't get to see them or talk to them that much. So I guess I'm glad I figured out how to do the Zoom. So that's
I'm that's proud of you, Coach.
I just clicked on. That's all I did.
I tried to make it easy. Nah, yeah. I'm just kidding with you. Nah, definitely. It's the same for me. Just I miss everyone at the tennis club. I miss getting to see you guys. Obviously, I miss the relationships I had with the students and helping them get better and grow their games. And hopefully we'll all be back out on court soon. And hopefully we'll be back to coaching college tennis soon. And all this will be in the past.
Yeah, it's good. And thanks for reaching out to me. And I mean, it's good to see you.
Yeah. Virtually.
Where are you at? Where are you at?
I'm in Fairmont right now. So
in Fairmont. Okay.
Yep.
In the studio, huh?
Yeah. In the studio, AKA the spare bedroom. So yeah, man. Thanks for coming on, Coach. Appreciate you having you today, man.
Yeah, good luck to you and all the stuff you're doing.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I'll talk to you later.
See ya. Bye.
See you, Terry.
Bye.